In the same sense that he said, I leave the world and go to the Father, in the same sense he says, I came from God, I came forth from the Father and come into the world. In John 6:62, it says he ascended up to where he was before. So he ascended to a place he had existed in beforehand. So he obviously existed before, and he ascended to there. And it's very good that Christ's ascent is literal, for his second coming is only as literal as his ascent. Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up in heaven? The same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven, so shall come in like manner as ye see him go into heaven. So if Christ's ascent were not literal, his second coming wouldn't be literal, and that would be a problem. So his ascent is literal, but his descent is as literal as ascent. So his descent was literal, his ascent was literal, his second coming will be literal also. And so modalists are inconsistent when they dissolve the descent of the Son to a metaphor, while leaving his ascent as a genuine reality. They're also inconsistent when they reduce Christ's descent to a metaphor, but believe that the Spirit's descent was the coming of one who is genuinely pre-existent. Because they say the Holy Spirit is the Father, and so when it says the Holy Spirit descended, that's literal. But when it says Christ descended, no, that's not literal. But in John 16, 5-7, Christ says, but now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you asketh me, whither goest thou? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. So if the sending of the Spirit is literal, not just some kind of metaphorical sending, the ascent of Christ, when he was sent by the Father, is also literal, just like his ascent. So I go my way to him that sent me, I go away, I will send the Comforter, are all equally literal statements. And if you're Oneness Pentecostal, you're into the Holy Spirit descending. I mean, that is like, because that's why you speak in tongues and so on. So you have to say the Holy Spirit's descent is literal. But if that's literal, so is the Christ going away, and so is the Christ's descending. And so if the Holy Spirit wasn't sent only in the sense that Elijah was commissioned, then Christ was not sent merely in the sense either. So the descent of Christ, the ascent of Christ, the second coming of Christ, the descent of the Spirit are all tied together as equally literal events. So you can't just decide, we can't say the Son's descent was literal because it doesn't work with our theology, so therefore we're going to get rid of that and keep the ascent of Christ and keep the second coming of Christ, keep the descent of the Spirit. You should get rid of them all, make them all metaphorical, or recognize that they're all literal, because they're all tied together. So when it says the Son was sent and he descended, he already existed before his descent and his existence. Do you see how they try to get out of the descent language, how it doesn't work? Yeah, good, okay. Also, John 17 is another passage that clearly testifies to the personal preexistence of Christ. John 17 talks about the covenant that the Father and the Son made to redeem the elect, how Christ, the Father, would elect them, the Son would die to save them, the Spirit would regenerate them, and the elect to the whosoever wills, and the non-elect to the whosoever wants. This is not soteriology, so I'm not going to get into that right now. But you can clearly see in John 17 these that there was this pre-existent agreement between the Father and the Son to save believers. And he obviously the one who is being spoken to exists. So as you read John 17, just think about how clearly the Son, Jesus Christ, who's praying to the Father, existed and was given things from the Father and stuff like that as from a distinct person. So John 17, these words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour's come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. So the Father gave the elect to the Son before the foundation of the world. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. So he was sent, he existed before he was sent. I have glorified thee on the earth, I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. He gave the work to him before the incarnation also. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. So before the world existed, Christ had divine glory with the Father. They both existed, they had this divine glory, and obviously you had to exist to have divine glory. Verse 6, I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Nine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. So here again, the Father gave the elect to the Son before the foundation of the world. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came not from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. And all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one, as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And the I who's speaking here obviously can't be an impersonal human nature. Only God is able to keep saved and prevent from being lost people. And so the one who's speaking here has to be, even though he's distinct from the Father, he also has to be divine, who's able to keep people saved. Verse 13. And now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself. I set myself apart, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. They all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will, that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. He existed and was loved before the foundation of the world, and the Father gave the elect to him at that time. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. So here the Son is able to declare the love of the Father to the elect, and he's able to do that, and that would not be possible if he wasn't a divine person, but he's also distinct. So very clearly in John 17, you can see that there's two distinct persons here, and the Father gave all believers to the Son for the foundation of the world. The Son would die for them and keeps every single one of them. If this is really just one person talking, Scripture doesn't mean anything. I mean, it's not revelation anymore. And I think on the handout, I'll go through, this explains on verse 19 on my part, and maybe it's verse 18 on yours. So the Son is said to have power to give eternal life to those the Father gave him. Eternal life is knowing the Father and the Christ, who the Father sent from his pre-incarnate state into the world. In the pre-incarnate state, the Son was given a work to accomplish by the Father. Upon his ascension, Christ receives again the full divine glory he had with the Father before the creation. In his state of humiliation on earth, it was hidden for a while. The Son was given the elect and the covenant of redemption in the pre-incarnate state before the Father sent the Son, verse 6 to 9. Christ guarantees the eternal security every believer the Father gave from eternity, keeping all of them so that none are lost. The Son gives the saints the word from the Father. That's not something an impersonal human nature can do. All believers have unity in us, the Father and Son, which requires both persons to be omnipotent and deity. That's also truth made clear from the fact the Son is in each saved person. If the Son is just a human nature, it can't be in every single saved person because the human nature is not omnipresent. The Father loved the Son even before the foundation of the world, verse 24. The Son reveals the Father to each one of the saints so that they may grow in love and have more of his indwelling presence. Such a revelation is only possible since the Son is personally distinct from the Father and yet also God by nature. So the omniscient Son can truly and fully know the infinite Father and can truly reveal him. So John 17 is very clear. The Father and the Son are distinct persons, and Christ existed before the incarnation. And you can see clearly distinct persons in the Trinity here. Any questions about that passage? It's very hard difficult to deal with in modalism. So John 17 clearly teaches the Father and Son existed before the incarnation as distinct persons. Paul is also very clear in Colossians 1:12-17. It says, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. The idea there, the firstborn of every creature, we'll look at this, dealing with Aaron injections, firstborn over the creatures. For by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. So here you can see the dear Son, the Son of the Father's love, is the image of the invisible God. He has the position of firstborn over the creation because, for, he's the creator. So he has his position of firstborn. Firstborn means it's a position of authority, which we'll talk about that later, dealing with Arianism. But he has his position of authority over the creation. Why? For by him were all things created. So he pre-existed because he's the creator. The Son is the one who created all things. The Son is the one who's before all things. And the Son is the one by whom all things consist. So he preserves and holds together the creation. You can't say that the creative work of 16 and 17 is really the Father. Like it's really the Father who's the creator. Because the pronoun him and the other pronouns in verse 16 and 17, the antecedent of the pronoun by him is the word Son, verse 13. That's just the grammar of the passage. So the Son is the creator in verse 16 and 17. That's grammar. You just can't get out of it. It's not the Father, it's the Son. The Son is the antecedent to the pronouns him. Also, the Son can't be an idea in the Father's mind of a coming human nature, because an idea can't create a universe. An idea can't hold together a universe. Only God can do that. If the word Son only referred to this foreknowledge of a human nature, then Christ also wouldn't be before all things, because God, from eternity, had all ideas in his mind. He knew that you were going to come into existence. You know, he knew that there was going to be a desk in this room. He foreknew everything in his mind. So if the Son is only this idea in God's mind, then he wouldn't have any priority over the other thoughts. They would all just be thoughts in his mind. So it must be a person who personally pre-exists before the creation of the world, not just some sort of thought that was in his mind. And it doesn't make any sense to say that God created the whole universe for the sake of an impersonal thought, but here the whole creation was for Christ. So what Colossians 1 is clearly saying is that the Father, through his personally distinct Son, created the entire universe for his Son's sake. Just like 1 Corinthians 8:6 says, there's one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him, and our one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. So, in footnote 17, you have about where it says some modalists affirm the various prepositions, Colossians 1:16-17, it might be 15 in yours. You have that?
19,
okay. David Bernard is a prominent Oneness Pentecostal in a book called The Oneness of God, trying to argue for Oneness Pentecostalism. And he says that Colossians 1 simply is showing that God used his foreknowledge of the Son when he created the world. That's what he tries to say that is all that's going on here. But it doesn't say that God used his foreknowledge of the Son. It says that the Son is actually the agent of the creation. It doesn't say that the Father created the world while thinking about a human nature. It says that by the Son, the creation came into existence. So, they can say, some of them say that it shouldn't be by him, it should be in him in this passage, that the Greek should simply say, instead of by him are all things created, it should just say in him are all things created. But even if you say it's in him, it would still show that he's a personal being distinct from the Father. So whether you say it's by him or in him, it still is showing he's a personally extant person through whom the world came into existence. So Colossians 1 shows both devastates both Arianism in showing the deity of Christ, and it devastates modalism in showing the eternal existence of the Son. Philippians 2:5-11 is another passage that's very clear on the distinct internal preexistence of the Son and his Father. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now, in this passage here, I have a footnote with some Greek words there, where it says, who being in the form of God, being is a participle that indicates concession and contemporaneous time. So although he was in the form of God, and the actual verb is thought it not robbery. So although he was in nature God, he did not think it robbery to be equal with God, but he emptied himself. Although he was in the form of God, he emptied himself. He didn't think it robbery to be equal with God. And the participles, the following participles also indicate contemporaneous times and means. So existing in the form of God eternally, he emptied himself by means of taking on the form of a servant and by means of being made in the likeness of men. So you can see, you don't need to know all kinds of Greek there, but this passage is clearly saying that he existed in the form of God before the incarnation, and then he became man. So he clearly had to pre-exist. Although he existed in the form of God already, he became man. So clearly, he existed eternally as the Son of God, and then he added a human nature to his already exit divine nature. So he took on him the nature or form of a servant, already having the nature or form of God. And he humbled himself to the point of death on the cross, and then the Father highly exalted him, giving him the name, openly giving him the name of all names. By the way, the name of Jesus isn't the name Jesus, it's the name of Jesus. It's actually Lord or Jehovah. So when it says that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, it's saying that the name that Jesus possesses, namely Jehovah, Lord, and every knee will bow to him. Verses 9 through 11, according to Isaiah 45:23. So very clearly, this shows that Jesus existed in the form of God before he came into the world and became incarnate. Some modalists try to say that this whole passage is only talking about Christ's incarnate state. So somehow, at some point in his earthly ministry, he stopped being equal with God and just became lesser. But that's extremely problematic. So in other words, like, let's say 1 year in, so he got baptized, and then he's in Mary's house, and it's, or someday during his earthly ministry, that day he said, okay, I'm going to stop being equal with God now. And that's all Philippians 2 is talking about. But you'd have to show how on some day during his earthly ministry, he became human. He was found in fashion as a man, while before that he wasn't. He was obviously equal to human the whole time. You'd also have to explain how Christ could be equal with God before this random point, and then he stopped being equal afterwards. And it would still not prove modalism, because there's still one who is equal with God, and who is yet Jehovah, and exalted by Jehovah, so it wouldn't work. It's a real stretch. Obviously, this is talking about a pre-incarnate state, and he became incarnate. Try to make it not a pre-incarnate state, you just have to really do some exegetical gymnastics, not be juggling like all kinds of things about the text. So Philippians 2:11 is very clear. Jesus is a distinct person with the Father. Let's do Hebrews 1, and I'll end with Hebrews 1, because then we're coming to the end of that section. Most modalists in Philippians 2, though, what they'll say is that all this is showing is that Jesus is equal in deity to the Father. But if Christ is equal with the Father in Philippians 2, he must be distinct from the Father, although equal in nature. Equal with doesn't mean the same person as. So what most modalists will say, if they don't go for the crazy, there is no pre-incarnate state in Philippians 2, they'll just say when it says he was equal with God, it means that he was the Father. But equal with doesn't mean same person as. It means you're somebody else who's equal. So when it says he was equal with the Father, It's not saying he is the Father. It's saying he's equal with the Father. So their explanation of Philippians 2 doesn't work. You can't say he is the Father. He's someone distinct from the Father, equal with him, was pre-incarnate, and became flesh. Okay, questions on Philippians 2?
You said that he was personally existent.
Existent.
Exist.
He existed. Is that a 40-40? 40-40 we're having.
No, I was just wondering. Personally existing?
In other words, both Christ and the Father existed in eternity past, and they were distinct.
Okay.
Yeah, so they both existed, they were distinct, but they both existed in eternity past in Philippians 2. Does that help?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
It just sounded like you kept saying personally extant.
Well, extant, I mean existent. Extant is, there's nothing wrong with that grammatically. So they're both persons
right.
who are extant. They exist.
Mm-hmm.
I don't mean like extinct or something like that. So extant.
I was thinking extant, like the canon is one of the proofs that the Bible is that it's always been available.
Oh, well, yeah. So in other words, it's not that they were available,
right.
but they both existed. Accent says it exists. And that's good. Yeah, if I use some word and you don't know what I'm saying, just, you know, scream.
So you were saying extant?
I was saying extant, yeah.
Oh, okay.
I was. Yeah, I was, and I mean, by that I meant he existed.
Okay.
So, yeah. Sometimes I use a word and I'm not thinking, you know, maybe this word is someone that somebody doesn't know. So, of course, by this point in the class, we can use terms that, you know, a lot of you know, we know all these fancy terms now. Like, Modalism, Arianism, Oneness Pentecostalism. Tres hypostases mea usia. You know, we should probably go over Hebrews 1, finish Hebrews 1 next time. Then we're going to look at the passages that they say prove their position. And then we're going to get into the deity of Christ in the Old Testament next time. Okay, well, let's sing a hymn praising the triune God. And we will end on there. Let's sing the hymn number 28 there. And it's a small meter, one small or short meter rather, that comes to mind is bum 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 bum. Do you know that tune? No? I don't know, I can't think off the top of my head a common short meter tune. Well, if you don't know a short meter tune, we'll sing a common meter one. That will be good. Let's sing, we'll sing number 30 then, and we'll sing common meter, Amazing Grace is a common meter tune. So that's easy enough. So we'll sing hymn 30, The God of Mercy Be Adored, to the tune of Amazing Grace, because everybody knows that tune. So. The God of mercy be adored, who calls our souls from death, who saves by his redeeming word and new creating breath, to praise the Father and the Son and Spirit all. Saints and angels join. Amen. Okay, you are dismissed.